Professor Dave again, let's map some genes.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We just looked at some early experiments regarding X-linked genes, which produced some of the first overwhelming evidence for the chromosome theory of inheritance. This set the stage for further efforts, largely by Thomas Hunt Morgan and his flies, whom we previously introduced. So let's take a look at what happened next. First, let's discuss how linkage affects inheritance in general. Humans have just 23 pairs of homologous chromosomes, but each chromosome contains hundreds or even thousands of genes. Thus, it is logical that many or most of the genes on a particular chromosome are inherited together. However, we now know that homologous chromosomes cross over during the prophase I of meiosis, producing recombinant chromosomes, so it will not be the case that 100% of the genes on a chromosome will be passed on to the offspring produced by fertilization of a particular gamete. This was not known by Morgan, but he did some work that set the stage for this understanding, again by looking at flies. In this case, two traits were examined, body color and wing type. Dominant traits are gray body and normal wings, represented by B+ and VG+, while recessive traits are black body and smaller vestigial wings, represented by B and VG. Morgan took flies that were homozygous dominant for both traits and bred them with flies that were recessive for both traits. The F1 generation was, as expected, heterozygous for both and thus displayed both dominant phenotypes, so all gray with normal wings. Then he bred females from the F1 generation with more homozygous recessive males to perform a test cross. Consider the possibilities. The gametes produced by the male must contain the recessive allele for each trait. The gametes produced by the female could be of four combinations, given the four alleles present in the organism. Thus, we would expect the offspring to display any of the four following genotypes, resulting in either both dominant phenotypes, just one, or just the other, or neither. Now, here's the interesting part. Let's say the genes that control these traits are on separate chromosomes. We would expect for the law of independent assortment to hold true, and each of these four results would be equally probable, resulting in about 25% of each genotype in the F2 generation, or a 1:1:1:1 ratio. Instead, if the genes were on the same chromosome, it could have been expected that the alleles would not separate, and only two genotypes would be possible, resulting in a 1:1:0:0 ratio. The experimental results showed something in between, closer to the second option, producing much more of the first two genotypes, but also some of the latter two. Morgan concluded that the two genes were indeed on the same chromosome, but that some process must sometimes break the connection between these genes and allow for rearrangement of alleles. Later, once we discovered that crossing over occurs during meiosis, this made perfect sense. Sometimes, homologous chromosomes can swap a portion of the chromosome containing one gene and not the other, resulting in a new combination for the gamete that would not have previously been expected. This is what is happening with the heterozygous females from the F1 generation in Morgan's experiment, allowing for some eggs to contain recombinant chromosomes, and fertilization of these is what accounts for the offspring with the genotypes that would have been unexplainable without this kind of process. Once this was understood, one of Morgan's students, Alfred Sturtevant, worked on the notion of a genetic map meant to elucidate the specific loci of genes within a chromosome. He reasoned that if crossing over can happen anywhere on the chromosome, then the farther apart two genes are, the more likely it is that crossing over will result in recombination. In other words, the more DNA there is between two genes, the more likely it is that crossing over will occur somewhere between them, thus allowing for recombination with respect to those genes, which we can describe as a recombination frequency. By looking at quantitative data regarding recombination frequencies for a variety of different pairs of genes, he was able to calculate how far apart different genes are on a chromosome, and thus, in essence, create a linkage map. For instance, if there is a recombination frequency of 9.5% for genes A and B, and the same for B and C, and 17% for A and C, the only way to place these genes within the chromosome that is consistent with this data is like this, with the genes in this order and approximately this far apart. This is, of course, quite complicated, but it represents an early attempt to map genes, and Sturtevant and his colleagues were quite successful in mapping many of the fruit fly genes along the four pairs of chromosomes in the organism. Although only approximate, it paved the way for future sequencing efforts and corroborated the chromosome theory of inheritance far beyond reasonable doubt. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.